Hello everybody, welcome back. Today we'll be building a brick breaker game. Now this game is quite interesting to play. It also provides us a very good opportunity to practice cloning, broadcasting, the nested loops, you know, a loop inside a loop. And also we introduce or we use a new concept of direction, right? So we are going to control, we are going to manipulate the direction of a sprite to create a certain movement. In this case, the movement of bouncing, right? So we'll have this ball bouncing on this platform as well as on the bricks, right? So overall, a very nice game to, you know, practice to get, let's say, more comfortable with the different features of Scratch, of programming, of logic. And on the, you know, interesting side, it's also a game that you can extend in many different ways, right? So I think it's a really nice game from that point of view. Let's just briefly, you know, before we get started, let's just take a look at, let's say, what this game is all about, right? So basically here we have a ball, right, which bounces off this pedal that I control as a player controls. And this ball goes and breaks all these bricks that are on top, right? And every time you break a brick, basically you go and hit the brick disappears, so it's sort of, you've broken that wall, and you score a point, right? Sometimes you get lucky, you get more than one, let's say one brick's broken. So you keep scoring a point for hitting a brick, but if you miss the ball, then, you know, the ball falls onto this floor and you lose, right? So you lose and basically you, the game gets over, right? So now to create this, so now, well, let's just start creating this game. For this purpose, I have a blank Scratch project. I have removed the cat sprite because I do not need the cat sprite for this project. Now, the first thing that I am going to do is to add a new backdrop. Now, remember, in my game here, in the you know, in the one I showed, there is this green, like a carpet, you can think of it, or like a grass, right, at the bottom of the screen. And that I did using a backdrop. So, I'll do the same thing here. I'll go to the backdrop section and I'll create a rectangle without any outline, right? So I'll do this here. Just, you know, I like green color, so I'll use that color and just create, let's say, a thin rectangle somewhere at the bottom here. Maybe this is a little bit too thick, so I'll just reduce this, right? So not very, very thin, but something like this is absolutely fine, right? So the idea here is that if the ball goes and touches this particular color, we are going to stop the game, right? So now you may think that I can use a sprite for this purpose. That's also fine, right? So you could very well create a sprite, which is basically like this floor. And if the ball touches that sprite, then the game gets over, right? Now here I have chosen to go the background route, which is also fine. And I have intentionally removed the outline here because I want the ball directly to go and touch this color, right? I'm going to push this condition later on, right? Now, having done this, now we are going to introduce the sprites, right? But let's just look briefly at our game from the, you know, from this. Basically, there are three sprites in this, right? One ball, one pedal, and third, the bricks, right? Now, the ball movement is basically, I mean, it's simply of reflection, right? So, ball is going and hitting, let's say, the brick and the pedal, and it's reflecting, right? So, today, for the sake of this video, I'm not getting into too much of the theory of this as to how we create a reflection. The broad idea is that in order to create reflection from a horizontal surface, we take the present direction of the ball and subtract that from 180, right? So if the present direction is, for example, 15, then the new direction post bouncing would be 180 minus 15, which is 165, right? This I have covered in a separate video. I'm putting that description, putting that link in the description. Please look at it because there we go quite deep into the entire concept of direction and how we can use direction, how we can manipulate direction to create this motion of the ball, which is that of bouncing, right? So I urge you, if you have not already seen that, please look at it because for this video, we will just use this fact that bouncing of a horizontal surface is equivalent to changing direction to 180 minus the direction, right? So with that in place, I will start developing my game with the pedal sprite, right? So what I will do now is to create a pedal sprite and then later on we'll create the bricks and then come back to the ball, right? So for the pedal sprite, right, basically it's very simple. We will use we'll go to a project here and I'll say create a sprite. I'll say paint a sprite and I'll call it pedal, right? So P-E-D-A-L. And for the petal sprite, I just want to create a thin rectangle, maybe say blue color. I mean, again, color is up to you. I'm going to use a blue color, a rectangle here with maybe, something like this. So not very thick, not extremely wide. I think something like this is just fine. Now make sure you center this thing because, oops. So deselect this and do center this, right? I'll remove this line here, which came by mistake. I will definitely go and center this. Now this is not just a good practice as such. It's in fact important because once you center, a sprite, you are sure that when you're using go to statement, it's going in a way that you intend it to go. Like this looks a little bit too big to me, so I'll make it a little bit shorter, right? Oops, this became big. Yeah, maybe this is fine. And I will again center it, right? So centering is important. Yeah. Now let's write some code for the pedal. Notice that my pedal basically goes to the bottom part of the screen, right? So it goes to the bottom part and thereafter I use it with the mouse, right? So this is in fact exactly same as what we did for the catch game, where the catching ball was at the bottom of the screen and the mouse was being used to move it, right? So I'll use the exact same code for my pedal. So which means that I'll say when the flag is clicked, go to, let's say something like, well, maybe I don't need to use go to, I'll use set y, right? Set y is a better choice. So I'll say set y to say -150, right? Now, this -150 need not be -150 for you. It could be -155, it could be -145, that's all right. The whole idea is that I want to put the pedal slightly above the grass, right? I mean, grass is this green thing. So I want to put the pedal slightly above this so that, there's some room for me to sort of play this game, right? Now, once having done this, then I can put a control loop. I can say forever set x to mouse x, right? So what that does is that it will take the x value of the pedal and make it equal to the x value of the mouse, right? Now, this is, like I said, exactly what we have done previously in the catch game, right? So I think this should be quite familiar. The moment I do this, then I see that my pedal moves along with the, along with, let's say this, with the mouse, right? Now, having done this, let us now create the brick sprite, right? Now, again, I'm going to say paint a sprite. This time, I'm going to create a rectangle, a very small one, and I want to keep it, let's say, just for the sake of, I like orange color. I mean, again, there's no compulsion that you must use these colors. In fact, you can use color effects here to create very nice, colorful bricks. Right, so maybe this looks a little bit big. I'll keep it small, right? Because it just feels better when it's small. It's easier to control. Now, very, very important here, make sure that this brick is centered, right? Because again, remember, you're going to clone this brick. So if it's not centered and you use set X or say go to X, it's or Y, the placement is going to get complicated, right? So it's the simplest thing whenever you are doing cloning or in general, right? I mean, there are exceptions, but in general, it's better to center every sprite like we have done here. So, and the way to center it is put the plus on that circle thing, right? So with this, your brick is centered. Let's also call it a brick, right? Now we are going to place this brick in a grid formation, much, much, much similar to what we have done for the whack-a-mole game. For the pits, right? Now the difference is that in case of pits, we had, let's say, maybe 9 pits or probably at most 15 pits, 3 times 5. But here we are going to put many, many, many more bricks, right? So we are looking at something like maybe 50 or 55 bricks, right? So for example, in my game here, in the game that I showed you just now, we can see it again. There are in fact 55 bricks that are being placed, right? So which means that, right? The only sensible way of doing this is to use cloning, because if you were to actually put 55 sprites out there, it's going to get completely messy and the code will blow up and you'll be totally confused, right? So which means cloning is the right thing to do here. Furthermore, we are going to use the same nested loop that we had done for the pits in the whack-a-mole game to place these bricks, right? So I've covered that separately in a separate video. So I'll go through it rather quickly, but let's just try to see it, once again, how we place the brick using that, right? Now, so the first thing I must decide is how many rows and how many columns do I want. So I will create, let's say, I'll go with when flag clicked. Of course, because I'm going to clone this, so I would recommend that you hide this brick. In fact, that's necessary because if you do not hide, right, if you do not hide this brick, what will happen is that after cloning, this brick will still be seen. And this will cause confusion because sometimes you are, you know, your behavior is being specified, assuming that everything is a clone, but this brick will still be around, right? So whenever you are doing cloning, in general, it's better to just hide the original and then clone with the, you know, show when the clone is formed. So then you know that you're dealing with the clone, right? Now I will create two variables here. The these variables will be called rows and columns, right? So basically how many rows I want, how many columns do I want, right? So I'll say make a variable, say columns, right? Okay. Now, so I can say set columns and set, let's say rows, to maybe say I'll try 11 columns and say, maybe 5 rows, right? Now the whole idea is that I'm going to be, I can hide these two, right? So I don't need this 11 columns and 5 rows. So I'm going to be creating, say 5 rows of these bricks, and each row will have 11 bricks. So that's why 5 rows and 11 columns. So the way to do it, you know, way to understand this, like I said, it's covered in detail in some video, in a video which is in the description. But the whole idea is that I'll first create one row, then I'll create the next row, and so on and so forth, right? So to create one row, what I can do is to say repeat, say in this case columns times. So I mean, instead of 11 times, I'll use a variable repeat columns times, right? I will, you know, okay, before this, before I go there, I should take my, you know, the x and y to this position. So I will go and say set x to lay something like, let's say minus 200, set y to maybe, let's say 160. Now again, it's not a compulsion that you must use these numbers, but here I'm just trying to put my brick somewhere in this corner. Now, once having done this, I say repeat column times, create a clone of myself, right? So create clone of myself, and change x by say 40, right? So I'll say change in the motion block, I'll say change x by, let's say 40, right? So if I just did this much, you know, that will create one row, but then for the row to be displaying, I should do, when I start as a clone, then I can just say show, right? So that will basically give me one row of bricks, as I can see here, nicely comes, and you know, it's quite neat, right? Now all I have to do is to repeat this 5 times, basically the number of rows. So I've done this for one row, I have to repeat this whole thing for 5 times, but before that I must set my x back to this number, and I must change my y to this string, right? So all I'll do is to go and say set x to, let's say minus 200, right? And I will change y by, say minus 40, right? Or maybe minus 20 is fine, right? Something like minus 20. If I did this, and then I just repeated this whole thing by rows times, right? So this time it's rows, and I think I with like this, you know, I expect to get a nice grid of bricks forming for me, and that's exactly what happens right now. Like I said, this entire loop I've discussed separately in a detailed video. I am also putting a link to another video where I discuss how you can change this loop to create more interesting patterns. For example, let's say a triangular pattern of bricks, let's say, you know, in different forms, right? So there's many things you can do with this, but the basic structure remains here, right? There are certain cares, certain precautions that you must take with respect to these bricks, because if you do not follow that, you know, the grid will not look as nice as it looks here for me, which is very nice and symmetric. What you might find is that all your bricks are falling at like one big clump, or perhaps the bricks are going in another direction, or perhaps they're just not appearing properly, right? So it's all to do with the size of the brick and these statements, right? So, you know, I have a separate video where I have captured the common problems that students run into when trying to do this grid. Take a look at that. Quite likely, if you're facing a problem here, it's related to one of those. Probably your brick is too large, in which case you need x more than, changing x more than 40, because, you know, if the brick is very large, then changing x by 40 may make the next brick overlap with this, and same in the y direction. So there may be some problems, but this video kind of captures it, right? So with this done, right, in my case, it's all falling in nicely because everything is chosen sort of to match the proportion. Now we will move forward. At this point, right? At this point, we are going to introduce the ball sprite, right? But the ball sprite has a very interesting role to play, let's say, right? Because, of course, that is the main weapon. What I want you to notice is that the ball sprite stays at this position until the bricks are formed, right? So just look at this again, right? So I have these bricks forming, but the ball sprite is just staying at that particular position, right? So that's an important one, and we are going to use broadcast to ensure that, right? So what we will do is we will we will go and say paint a sprite again, right? Let's call it the ball, right? Ball sprite. For the ball, I will just use a circle. I'll use a red colored ball. And to get a perfect circle, I will click shift. I'll use circle and just click shift to create, let's say, something like this, right? That size is perfectly fine. But once again, make sure you center this, right? In fact, this is very, very important, because you're going to change the direction. If the centering is not good, then every bounce, you'll notice that there's a very abrupt jerk that the ball is seeing, right? And look very, very odd, right? So make sure the costume gets centered nicely. Right now, on the ball sprite, remember, in the beginning, right, when the game starts, all I want is that the ball sprite should be sitting, let's say, at one position, and that position logically could be 0-0, right? So maybe what I can do is, on the ball, I can, I'm coding for the ball now, I can say when the flag is clicked, show, so that, so the ball shows, go to 0-0, so x0 and y0, right? So go to 0-0. So basically the ball will be sitting there. Now, when the grid is completely formed, I want the ball to start moving, right? So I want the ball to start moving once the grid is completely formed. And how can I do that? Well, the simplest method of doing that would be to use a broadcast. And that's exactly what I will do. So I will say, let's go to the brick code and broadcast a so I'll use this event, say broadcast a message, let's say called a new message called bricks ready. Now, this is exactly same intent as we did in the whack-a-mole game, where we had pits ready. So the pits were ready, and then you could have the player coming out. Right here, the bricks are now ready, the ball can start moving, right? So, that makes sense, because otherwise the ball may just start moving before the bricks are ready, and in fact, it can go in, just looks very odd, right? It looks very illogical. Now, how do I make use of this broadcast? This broadcast is being sent from the brick sprite, but I really want to make use of this in the ball sprite, right? So what I will do is, I will say, when I receive this particular broadcast, then I will start moving, right? So this part basically is, the code is not hard, but I have to be a little bit careful about this, right? So a little bit careful about what I am trying to do here. So what I'll do is, I'll say when I receive bricks ready, right, I will start moving, but I would want to move in a direction that is away from the bricks, right? In other words, I would want to move towards the pedal. The reason is because, remember, the bricks will eventually be coded to be broken when the ball hits them, right? So if the ball starts moving upwards, right, if the ball starts moving upwards, then the ball will immediately start breaking these bricks, because it's just moving there, it will touch these bricks and break them, right? And that's very strange, because the game is all about bouncing the ball off this pedal and then breaking the bricks, right? So you do not want the bricks to be broken before the player is coming to play, right? So to ensure of that, what we will do is, we will make sure that the ball goes only in a downward direction, right? So and you notice, we can see that here, first the bricks are formed, ball is stationary, then the ball starts moving downwards, right? So exactly the same thing I want to do here. What I will do is to ensure that, I will use point in direction, because that's how we control the direction. So I'll say point in direction. Now again, if you know angles, very good, you can just use this directly. But if you do not know angles, use scratch to guide you, right? Notice, if I send point in direction 180, right? If I set point in direction 180, the ball will exactly point in the direction downwards. And when I say move, it will come exactly down. And we can see that. So I say point in direction 180. Let's say, I'll say control forever, maybe move, let's say, move some number of steps. So move, let's say five steps, right? Let's say I did this. So what will happen is that ball will notice after the Bixer form, ball will fall exactly down. So of course, I'm not told anything else. So it just fell down and just went and, waited there, right? So I definitely want the ball to come downwards, but I wouldn't want it to come perfectly downwards, right? So instead, what I really want is that the ball should come towards me at a certain angle, like maybe let's say something like this. So in this direction, say that's minus 165 or probably minus 150. Also, I want the ball to come towards the pedal in different directions so that the pedal has to be alert and pick up, where the ball is going, right? So, I want the ball to come from anywhere from this direction to say this direction, right? So 150. How can I do that? Well, again, I can use, instead of saying pointing in, let's say 180 alone, I can say I could go, 180 is this exactly downwards. I could say I will do 180 plus say 30, or I could do 180 minus 30, right? Now here, if you see 180 plus 30 looks like minus 150 to you. But that's really because, that's where geometry comes into play. That's because this whole thing is 360 degrees. So if this is 150, which is what Scratch is reporting, in fact, this is 210, right? So 180 plus 30, right? So what I will do is that I will say point in a direction and I use an operator here to say, look, I will make it, so I'll say 180 plus pick random, say minus 30 to 30, right? So what this will do is that it will, every time the game starts, the ball will end up in a downward direction, all right, but in a slightly random direction between 180 is exactly downward, so 30 degrees this way or 30 degrees that way. And like I said, the best way to see that is using these arrows, so either in this way or from here, right? So this is the whole intent here, right? So now I can say we can see every time I click the flag, the ball will move. Once the bricks are formed, balls will move in a slightly different direction, right? Because ball direction is being chosen randomly, right? So this was much more inclined this way. And then if I choose this, let's say, the ball is going the other direction, which is what I wanted, right? Because there's some amount of randomness I want to create. Now I can at this point create a variable to control how many steps the ball moves, right? So I can just say, make a variable, let's say ball steps, right? Or we can just call it steps. That's also all right. So I will say move ball step step. And of course, when the flag is clicked, I can say set ball steps to set ball steps to perhaps 5, right? Again, having a variable is good because that lets us control this much more cleanly, right? If I want to change the speed later on, we can do so. So now here, one thing I want to point out that I'm using this ball steps when the bricks are ready, right? So this guarantees to me that the ball step would have been set to 5 before this loop ever comes into play, right? So that is important because I do not want some confusion to happen. Sometimes a variable is not set and we try to use it, right? So that you have to be careful. But here I'm guaranteeing that almost by design, right? So here ball moves, right? And the ball starts moving in whichever direction, right? So a random direction towards the pedal, right? Now let's give a little bit more code to the ball. Right. So as always, I want the ball to bounce off the edges, right? Not this bottom edge, but I do want it to bounce off all these other three edges. Right. So what I will do is I'll say if, in the control loop, I can say if touching edge, right? So if touching edge, then, so I'm going to make it bounce, but I also want to play a small sound here. So I'll say start sound pop, and then I can just use when on edge. If on edge, then bounce, right? So what this will do is the ball will now start moving around, right? So you notice ball makes a small pop sound and it also bounces off, right? So the game kind of starts to become alive here, right? In fact, this is important because the ball will basically also bounce off these edges because you need that, right? Later on, of course, we'll put a condition that if the ball is touching this green patch, then the game gets over, right? So we will take care of this here. So now the ball is moving. Right now, we are going to create code for the ball to reflect off the pedal, right? Notice the pedal is where the ball has to bounce off. So we will now create that code so that the ball bounces off the pedal, right? To do so, it's actually not that hard at all, right? What I can do is I can say forever when the flag is clicked, right? So after the flag is clicked, whenever the ball touches the pedal, right? you know, it should just bounce, right? And how do I bounce? Well, I can take its direction that is presently there. I can convert the direction, I can rather change the direction to 180 minus the present direction. That's the law of reflection. Like I said, the video in the description talks about this in more detail. Here, I'm just going to use it, right? So I'll say, okay, look, when the flag is clicked, right, forever, right, if touching pedal, right, so if touching, let's say, pedal, right, this is pedal, really, I can just change the direction here, but I will use a broadcast, right? So I will use a broadcast here, and the reason for that will become a little bit more clear as we do more coding, right? So I'll say, in the event section, I'll say, broadcast, let's say, I'll use a new broadcast here, new message called, maybe I can call it bounce, right? So I'll say broadcast bounce, right? And what does this bounce do? Well, it's very simple. When I receive bounce, notice I'm in the ball. So when I receive bounce, when the ball receives bounce, all it does is to point in the direction given by, point in direction, which is given by an operator where I go and set 180 minus the, in the motion section, I'll go and say 180 minus direction, right? So point in direction, 180 minus direction. And then I'll say, you know, I can also add a little bit. I like this to add a sound here whenever, you know, this happens. So the particular sound I like, again, you know, there's no compulsion. You must use this. The sound that I like is this thing called tennis hit. Tennis hit. So I'll use this. I just like it. So what I'll do is I'll say start sound tennis hit, right? So now, you know, notice that all that will happen is whenever the ball is touching the pedal, it will broadcast this bounce. And when the bounce is received, the ball's direction would change to 180 minus direction, which means the ball will actually start going backwards, or, you know, ball will reflect back. At the same time, this sound tennis hit will be briefly played, right? Now, just to make this whole thing a little bit more stable, I will add a small wait here. Maybe something like, let's say, 0.3 seconds or something, right? So now, one question you might have is, why did I put this on when flag clicked? Why not on when I receive bricks ready? Well, actually, you could have put it on that as well. But here, I'm just sure that till the bricks are ready, anyway, the ball is sitting on the center, right? So this condition is not happening. Hence, I can just put when flag clicked. But you will also be okay, I think, putting when I receive bricks ready, right? So that's all right. So now let's see if this thing works. Notice the ball nicely reflects back, and I get this sharp tennis hit sound, which I, like I said, feels quite nice here, right? The reason it's reflecting is because we are manipulating its direction to give us a feeling that the ball is getting reflected off this pedal, right? Now, focusing our attention on the bricks, right? So we have created these bricks. The bricks are in a, you know, in a, in grid already. Now we are going to start scoring some points, right? So, and in fact, there's some interesting things that happen here, right? So what I will do is I will create a variable here. Let's say make, I don't need this ball steps. I can create a variable called score, right? So I will say, make a variable called score. And in the beginning, I'll say set score to zero, because when the game starts, I want the score to be zero. Now I want the score to increment, score to increase every time the ball hits the brick, right? So if the ball goes and hits a brick, I want the score to increase, and I will do this from the brick sprite. And I'll tell you why I did it from the brick sprite a little bit later. So what I'll do is that in the brick sprite, I will tell the brick that whenever the ball is touching you, right, you should give yourself, you should increase the score by one, right? So, you know, this code is already there. When I start as a clone, I'm just going to write a little bit more code on this. So then I say, okay, look, forever, right? So I should, of course, once the start is clone is done, then forever I should keep doing this. If touching ball, right? So if, let's say, in the sensing block, I'll say if touching ball, right? So which means that the brick is touching the ball, then I will say change score by one. So I obviously I score a point here, right? And I can then again make use of the broadcast that I've created called bounce, right? So now, why did we do that, right? Why did we create, I told you we create a broadcast here And I told you the reason for that will become evident a little bit later. I want to just take a moment here to kind of talk about this because this is very, very interesting and also somewhat important from scratch point of view, right? Notice, when we did broadcast long time ago, we spoke about three uses of broadcast. One was to sequence things. One was to do something on one sprite, which happened as a result of something else on another sprite. And third one was when two events lead to the same outcome, right? So these are three use cases. In fact, we are seeing all these three in this game, right? The first one, you know, we have used broadcast bricks ready. So all of this happens before the ball starts to move, right? So that is sequencing this. Now, notice, look at this particular thing, right? Here, the brick is hitting the ball, but the ball has to change its direction, right? So brick is hitting the ball, but the ball has to change the direction. So the, you know, action on one sprite is causing an effect on another sprite. Hence, broadcast is the right way to go. And finally, as we have seen, broadcast bounce here is also happening when the ball is touching the pedal, right? So it's like, you know, two conditions leading to a similar outcome, right? So that's why this, we have put this as a, you know, as a broadcast here, and we can just call this broadcast over here, right? So if I did this now, right, everything looks fine, but actually this game has a very interesting flaw right now. So I want to do it because students run into this problem, right? So if I play this, notice what will happen, right? Notice my score keeps increasing, but the ball seems to get stuck over there, right? Now, why did this happen, right? Really, because what's going on here is that when I start as a clone forever, if I'm touching the ball, right? If I'm touching the ball, then I keep broadcasting bounce, right? And what does bounce do, right? Ball bounce basically changes the direction of the ball. So the ball, you know, is going upward for 1 minute at one moment, and the next moment is coming downward because this touching condition is always happening. It's always broadcasting. So the ball is just going for like back and forth. It looks like it's getting stuck inside the bricks, right? So how do we avoid that? Well, it's actually very simple, right? In fact, you notice the score also keeps running away. That's because the ball is just continuously touching the brick, right? So how do we avoid this thing? Very simple. I can say once all this happens, right, I can just go and delete this clone, right? So if I do that, then the first touch itself will cause a bounce. I'll get 1 point and the ball will, you know, kind of not get trapped over there, as you notice now. So everything's just moving perfectly fine, right? It's getting, the ball is coming back nicely, right? So, right? So this kind of works fine, right? So we have pretty much got everything in here, right? We have to do now is to create conditions for the game to end. But before I go there, right, I just want to make one point, which, you know, a little bit something for you to think about, like kind of food for thought, right? Why did we put this condition of touching the ball inside the bricks, right? Whereas for when it came to the pedal, we have done it in the ball, right? So we said with ball touching pedal, why did we not do if ball touching bricks, right? So really the question is, it's actually a little bit deeper than what you might think in the beginning. See, the whole argument is this way, right? That whenever if I do it in the brick, then I have to send a broadcast to make the ball bounce, right? If I did it in the ball, on the other hand, right? So then I would have to send a broadcast to delete the brick clone. Remember, because this will be an action on the ball sprite, which should cause an effect on the brick sprite, right? So I'll have to send a broadcast to delete this clone. And as you will find out, you know, in the subsequent lessons, I think in the snake game, when we start looking at local variables and so on, broadcast and cloning together have to be handled very, very carefully, right? So that's why I prefer here to generate the, you know, the touching condition inside the clone, the bricks that are being cloned. So I generate it inside that and I broadcast this thing so that the ball takes care of the bounce, right? So that's the reason this has been done in this way, right? So like I said, this will become more clear as we go along in this course. But here I've chosen this way, right? So anyway, moving forward, now I want to code the ending conditions, right? Now, really, there are two ways this game can end, right? One is that you finish all the bricks, right? So you are, you know, basically hitting the bricks one by one. If you finish all the bricks, then the game gets over. That's one. The other condition is that you lose the game, right? So let's just code both of them. What I'll do is that I will add a couple of backdrops to my, repository of backdrops. So I'll duplicate this twice. Right, the second backdrop I'll just say is, let's say, think of it as a losing backdrop. So you say, oops, you lost, right? So, and this happens, oops, maybe I can write, oops, you lost, right? And this could happen when For example, the ball goes and touches the green color part, right? Which means that you missed to collect the ball, and the ball went in. You know, I can use, let's say, maybe, yeah, this looks good. Yeah. So I'll say, oops, you lost. And then in the third one, I can write, you know, I can again use a text here, and I can say, well done, you won, or something like that. Well done. Then you won. Right. So what can I do here? I can maybe certainly put this to center, and I can also, you know, change the color a little bit, right? So it looks a bit different, right? So very simple. I mean, you guys can do more, but then this is just the concept, right? So basically what I can do is I'm first going to code the losing condition, which is that if the ball goes and touches the green color, right? So that's part is simple. I'll go and just create another loop here. When flag is clicked, right? So for the ball, when the flag is clicked, I will say forever, right? So forever, you know, if touching color green. So if, let's say, touching color, you know, I want to do a green color. Again, do not go with your eyes. Use the dropper tool. So select on this, go select this portion here, right? So if I go and select this touching color green, using a dropper tool, I know that the colors are set up correctly. If touching this color, then I can just broadcast a message called game over, right? So broadcast, let's say, new message, game over, right? And then of course I need to tell what to do when the game gets over. So I can say, when I receive, say, game over, I can switch the backdrop to, right? I can switch backdrop to, I think it was backdrop 2, which is the losing backdrop, and we can just test that backdrop 2. And then finally I can say stop everything, right? So that will basically end the game. Since I'm doing this, I must make sure that the backdrop switches to the correct backdrop when the flag is clicked, when the game first starts, right? So I must make sure that backdrop switches to, let's say, let's call it backdrop 1, right? So I think when this happens, the game starts properly. I'll just deliberately lose this, and yes, it just says, oops, you lost, right? So this is the simple, you know, condition. I think we've done this before several times. You can choose to go and hide these sprites if you want to, and you can do many fancy things there, right? Now coming to the winning condition, right? Now winning condition can be a little bit more involved. The whole idea is that if you have hit all the bricks that are out there, right, if you have hit every brick, then you have won the game, right? So what I will do is that I'll keep track of the score. I will wait until the score reaches the total number of bricks, right? And how do I know what is the total number of bricks? Well, it's just, we have 5 rows and 11 columns, which means that the total number of bricks is 5 multiplied by 11, which is 55, right? And if you do not believe me, you can actually count these bricks, right? So there'll be 11 this way, 5 this way. It's just, you know, this multiplied by this, which is totally 55 bricks, right? So what I will do is that I will say, when the flag is clicked, right? So when the flag is clicked, I will use, you know, this function called wait until. And I think this is really cool because I do not have to then use any forever, right? So I can say wait until, you know, the score becomes, so let's say I can put a condition, wait until score is equal to rows multiplied by columns, right? And the reason I'm doing rows multiplied by columns is because that is just the total number of bricks that is in there, right? So once you change rows and columns, this will also change, right? I mean, this will automatically take care of itself, right? So I'll say wait until score is equal to rows until columns. And when that happens, you can say, you know, I can broadcast let's say a message called broadcast victory, right? Perhaps. So I can say broadcast new message called victory, CTORY, broadcast victory. And then I can say, when I receive victory, you know, I can say, okay, look, when I receive victory, switch backdrop to backdrop 3, right? So I think backdrop 3 is my winning backdrop. And again, I can stop everything, right? Now, of course, you can choose to go to a next level and so on. So there's so many things you can do with this structure in place, right? So this is just a general structure, right? Now, to illustrate this whole thing, let's say I made, so they kind of come 5 columns and just say 1 row, and then I, you know, I just want to place it somewhere in the middle. So I've got just 5 bricks here. just to sort of illustrate what I'm trying to do, that the game should get over, right? So if I did this, notice one brick is gone, right? Okay, so I have to be a little bit more patient here, and hopefully this time it will... Okay. Yeah, to be quite patient, I guess, to finish off these five bricks. Oh, yeah, just missed it, so... Okay, and I think one more, and I should be done, right? So... all I'm trying to wait for is that once the game gets over, okay, I have to wait a little bit longer, looks like. Right now, I want to communicate to you that this wait until works. Hopefully this time, oops, no. Okay, I think this time I should get it. And it says, well done, you have won. Right now, the good thing with this implementation really is that I do not need to use any forever, so it looks a lot more neater. I'm just waiting. For the score to rise. So score keeps rising. Now in this case, score became 5. That's 5 times 1. And that means all the bricks have been hit, right? And this is one way you can decide that you have won, right? The wait until is good because it's just very clean. This event happens only once. Once and only once. And hence you can use it, right? So with this, the game is ready. I hope you like this video. I hope you enjoy building this game. And like I said, this can be extended in many, many different ways, right? So... well, as before, enjoy programming, enjoy Scratch. Take care. Bye-bye. Thank you.